Hello and welcome to Daily Current Affairs by Neo IAS. Today is 17th September 2019. So I'll tell you what all we'll study today. So basically we have six topics over here. So first topic is the International Day for Preservation of Ozone Layer. We'll go into detail in this particular topic. Then we have electric vehicles, then LEAP and ARPIT. Then we have steel import monitoring system and NIRVIC scheme. All these four topics, it's like prelims perspective. So we'll deal according to the prelims perspective view. Then we have a current affairs capsule. It's a very small news yet important for prelims. Okay, then we'll have map-aided program. We are doing a series now. We are doing with tiger reserves in the country. So we'll be continuing with the tiger reserves in map-aided program. And in previous year question revision series, we'll discuss one question from the already asked prelims questions. Okay, so we'll start with the first topic. That's the International Day for Preservation of Ozone Layer. So I'll tell you why this is in news. Because we are observing the International Day of Preservation of Ozone Layer on September 16th. So that is why it was in news. So what is ozone layer? It is basically a shield of gas. It protect the earth from the harmful portion of rays coming from the sun, and it will also help the existing life on the planet. So it has high concentration of ozone. Ozone is basically O3. So it is having high concentration in relation to other part of the atmosphere. So stratospheric ozone, there is ozone in the stratospheric layer also. It is not harmful, but its presence on the land, it will be harmful. Okay, so the substances like chlorofluorocarbon, halones, then carbon tetrachloride, so these substances are responsible for ozone layer depletion. So the ozone layer absorb most of the ultraviolet radiation reaching the earth from sun. So the ozone layer in the atmosphere, it is more thicker over poles than over equator. Okay, so how is this ozone layer created? So when the sun's rays splits the oxygen molecules, so the oxygen molecules become single atoms. Okay, so like that the ozone is created in the atmosphere. These single atoms, they combine with the nearby oxygen to form three oxygen molecule. That three oxygen molecule is called as ozone. Okay, so why is it important? Why is ozone layer important? One thing, as I have already told you, it will protect the earth from harmful ultraviolet rays that is coming from the sun. So the plants cannot live and grow in heavy ultraviolet radiations, nor the planktons. The planktons that serve as food for most of the ocean life, they also can't exist with heavy ultraviolet radiation. So with weakening of ozone layer shield, human will be more vulnerable or susceptible to skin cancer, then eye diseases like cataract, then it will also affect the immune system. It can lead to impaired immune systems. Okay, so that is why ozone layer is so important. And what is ozone layer depletion? Again, the chemicals containing chlorine and bromine atoms, they are released into the atmosphere through various human activities. So what they do, these chemicals, they combine with a certain weather condition that will cause the ozone layer, leading to the ozone molecules that will get destroyed. Okay, so the depletion of the ozone layer, they occur globally, but severe depletion of ozone layer over Antarctica, it is very severe and it is called as ozone hole. So increased depletion has recently occurred in the Arctic as well. So you can in near future you can also see ozone hole in the Arctic region as well. So what is the remedy that has been taken by the international arena because of this ozone depletion and ozone depleting substances? How has the world dealt with this issue? That is the Montreal Protocol. So what is it? It is basically an international treaty. It is to protect the ozone layer. How? It will phase out the production of ozone depleting substances, which are responsible for all the ozone depletion happening today. So it was followed by a meeting in Helsinki also in May 1989. Okay, so this was agreed on in 1987 in Montreal. Montreal is in Canada, and it entered into force in 1989. 1989 in Helsinki. Then under this, which all are our band? One is chlorofluorocarbon, then there is methyl chloroform, then we have CTC, halons, methyl bromide. These all are phased out globally. So, it is a legally binding agreement on all the member countries, and it has been also ratified between 197 parties, and it is also known as a universally ratified protocol in United Nations history. Okay, so that is all about ozone depletion and the international year, everything. So, the next topic is electric vehicles, EVs. So, why this is in news? So, there is a commission called as DDC. It's a Dialogue and Development Commission. It is of Delhi. They actually are pushing for transition to e-vehicles in the city because of the pollution happening in the city. So, that is why it is in news. So, what is EV? Basically, EV or electric drive vehicle, it is a vehicle that use one or more electric motors for propulsion. So, what is a major feature of EVs is that the driver can plug them into charge from an off-board electrical power source. Okay. So, this distinguishes them from the hybrid electric vehicles. Hybrid electric vehicles is basically the internal combustion engine with a battery power, but it cannot be plugged in. Okay. So, there are different types of EVs. This is what is important for your exam. So, there are different types of EVs. One is, the typical EV, which is the plug-in electric vehicles, derive all the parts or the part of their power from electricity supplied from a power grid or an electric grid. Okay, so that particular EV is again divided into two. One is AEV and PHEV. AEV is all electric vehicles. It has been powered from one or more electric motors. So, they receive electricity by plugging into the grid and store. It can be stored in the batteries. So, they consume the power, not the petroleum-based fuel, and it will not produce the tailpipe emissions that you can see while traveling in the city. So, AEV, it is included with the battery electric vehicles and the fuel cell electric vehicles. So, it is BEV and FCEV. And we have the other type of EV called as PHEV, that is the plug-in hybrid electric vehicles. So, they use the batteries to power as an electric motor. Then, they plug into the electric grid to charge, and they use a petroleum-based. It's basically a hybrid. Okay, petroleum-based internal combustion engine as well. So, some of the PHEVs are also called as extended range electric vehicles, that is EREVs. Okay, so that is all about electric vehicles. We are moving to the next topic, that is LEAP and ARPIT. So, why this is in news? Because the LEAP and ARPIT, two programs under MHRD, that has been launched under Pandit Madan Mohan Malaviya National Mission on Teachers and Training, that was held in New Delhi. So, this will come under Ministry of Human Resource and Development. So, we'll go to the first one, that is LEAP. LEAP is basically Leadership for Academicians program. So, what is it? It is to build, higher managerial capabilities of existing education leaders and administrators, and also to bring more fresh talent into the management of higher education system. So, it is basically this scheme is to bring more managerial capacity to the higher education level. So, it was launched to design and deliver a structured scheme for leadership. Okay. So, the main objective is to prepare a second tier academic head that who are potentially, who can go up to a leadership level in future. That is the main aim of LEAP. So, the main eligibility or condition of the person who is going into the LEAP scheme should have a minimum 8 years of experience as a professor, or like 3 years of experience as an administrator, or even he should have at least gone for around 30 publications in a public journal or an international journal or an approved journal, and he should be below the age of 58 years. So, a maximum of 10 lakh per participant is approved, and each training institution, they sign a MOU with the foreign counterpart. So what we are aiming is to bring about a international standard in the higher secondary level. Okay, so coming to the next one, that is ARPIT, which stands for Annual Refresher Program in Teaching. So this is also coming under MHRD. So this was launched in November 2018. It's not a new program. So this basically, it's a unique initiative of online professional development. It is around 1.5 million higher education facilities using a MOOC platform, that is a massive open online course platform under Swayam portal. Okay, so ARPIT is it's a major and unique initiative, as I've already told you. So for the implementation of ARPIT, so there should be national resource centers in various part of the country. So they are tasked to prepare online training materials with focus on latest development in discipline or in new emerging trends and in various improvements in the education field. So through ARPIT, all the in-service teachers, irrespective of their subject or seniority, they will be given an opportunity to keep up with the latest development and the discipline which is happening in the education field. Okay, so the course is like around a 40-hour module and 20 hours of video content, and they'll also provide it in a flexible format also in their own pace and time, so you can access it from wherever you want. So at the end of the course, they will be a terminal assessment, according to which an decision will be taken about them completing the course. So there will be an online exam. That exam will be conducted by National Testing Agency. Okay. The next topic we are going to deal is Steel Import Monitoring System, that is SIMS. So SIMS, I have already dealt it in some other sessions, but I'll repeat this for you today. So the Union Minister of Commerce and Industries and Railways, and also the State Ministry for Commerce and Industries, so they all came together in order to launch the Steel Import Monitoring System. This also happened in New Delhi. So the system has developed in consultation with the Ministry of Steels on pattern of US Steel Import Monitoring and Analysis, that is SIMA system. So that is a system, our counterpart in US. So we have made online of SIMA, the SIMS also. So the SIMS will actually provide advanced information about steel imports to the government and the stakeholders. So who are all the stakeholders? The steel industries, the steel consumers, that's the importers, and they'll all get the information, advanced information for effective policy interventions. Okay, so in this particular system, the importers of the specified steel products, they will have to register in advance on the web portal. So web portal will be given by SIMS. So the registration will be online and automatic, and there is no need of any human interventions. So the importer can apply for registration and he will be getting this import consignment on an expected date. So the automatic registration number, it will there will be a number for automatic registration, and this will remain on the portal for 75 days also. Okay, so the information about the steel imports provided by the importers on SIMS will be also monitored by the steel ministry. So it will be very transparent also. Okay, the next topic is NIRVIK scheme. So, why NIRVIK scheme is in news? Because again, the same ministry is involved, the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. They, through this Export Credit Guarantee Corporation, that is ECGC, they introduced NIRVIK scheme. It is also called as Export Credit Insurance Scheme, in order to enhance the loan availability and ease the lending process. Okay, so the ministry involved is Commerce and Industry Ministry, and also they are acting through Export Credit Guarantee Corporation. Okay, so this NIRVIK scheme is basically for the gems, jewelry and diamond sector borrowers. So what happens is that usually in gems, jewelry and diamond sector, the loss ratio is very high. So they won't usually get this higher credit rating. So what ECGC is doing, they are providing additional comfort to these to the banks or the borrowers, so that they get a better credit rating, that's the AA rated account. So So only if they have a AA rated account, they can borrow more. Okay, so the enhanced cover, it will ensure the foreign and the rupee export credit interest rate. It will be around how much? 4% and 8% for exporters. So that will help the exporters actually. So under this this NIRVIK scheme, the insurance cover percentage has also been enhanced to 90%, which was earlier the 60% for both principal and interest. These are all not very important things, but you have to keep in mind some statistics regarding every scheme. Okay, so the scheme, it will also aims to simplify the procedure for settlement of claims and also for the payment of up to 50% within the 30 days of purchase. Okay, and the scheme will mandate inspection of the bank documents and the records by ECGC officials. Okay, so they will have to go into each and every account related to the scheme. So there will be more transparency. Okay, so who is ECGC, by the way? So ECGC is a fully government owned company. It was established in 1957. So they are to promote exports by providing credit insurance services. So they give credit insurance to banks to protect the banks from losses on account of export credit. Okay. So there will be losses on before shipment, after shipment. So this will be protected. This will be insured by ECGC. So that is their role. Okay. Next, we have a current affairs capsule. This is a very small news, that is RSN, RTN, IN. So, it is a trilateral exercise. It involves Republic of Singapore Navy, Royal Thailand Navy and Indian Navy. This exercise will be done in Port Blair and it's a 5-day long exercise. It is aimed at, you know, making better relations between the maritime neighbors like Thailand and Singapore. So it will contribute significantly to enhance the maritime security in the region. So this is basically a trilateral exercise between Singapore, Thailand and India. It's a naval exercise. Okay. So coming to the map aided program, as I told you, we are continuing with the tiger reserve in the country. So Achanak Mar Wildlife Sanctuary, this is a tiger reserve from Chhattisgarh. It's in the Mungeli district of Chhattisgarh. So it was established in 1975 under WPA Act. Later it was declared as a tiger reserve in 2009. So this is also a part of Achanak Mar Amarkantak Biosphere Reserve. So this is actually connected to Kanha National Park in Madhya Pradesh as well. So this is a corridor. Okay, so the sanctuary, it is very close to Amarkantak also. So Amarkantak is famous for Narmada River, Son River. It is famous for the radial drainage. Okay, so that's the best example in India for radial drainage. Note it, okay. So these are the specification of Achanak Mar. So as I told you, it's a corridor. So it is famous for Bengal tigers. Then there is Dhol, Usuri Dhol is there. Then famous striped hyena. Then you have Indian bison. Indian bison is also called as gaur. Okay. So these are the famous animals in the region. We can also see many carnivores, many birds, many other vertebrates in the tiger reserve. But which is mainly that corridor you have to remember. Kanha in Madhya Pradesh and also Achanak Mar in Chhattisgarh. Okay. So, I have marked Amarkantak in the Chhattisgarh map. So, you can see it. There are other regions, other wildlife sanctuaries and national parks also. Okay. Next is the previous year question revision series. I'll read out the question. Among the following states, which one has the most suitable climatic conditions for the cultivation of a large variety of orchids with minimum cost of production and can develop an export-oriented industry in this field? So, option A is Andhra, option B is Arunachal Pradesh, option C is Madhya Pradesh and option D is Uttar Pradesh. So, basically orchid. Think of orchid. It's a subtropical flower and it is a decorative flower. It's subtropical. It needs a moderate condition to grow. So, think of it, which is the most suitable location for a subtropical plant or a subtropical flower to bloom. So it is none another than Arunachal Pradesh. So Andhra is very hot. It's not a moderate climate. Madhya Pradesh is also a somewhat arid region. Uttar Pradesh, even though it is, somewhat favorable conditions are there, but it's not subtropical. Okay, so the only option left is Arunachal Pradesh. So the answer is Arunachal Pradesh. So that's all for today, guys. I hope you enjoyed the session. If you have any doubt relating to prelims or mains or the discussed topic or any discussed topic of the previous session, let me know in the comment section today, because I'll be replying today itself for all your queries in the comment section. So thank you so much. Good night.